So, but let's start with Impute. When we think about applications where we need connection to blockchain, there we have first the space IoT. Christoph already mentioned it. So when we started at Slockit to work with IoT devices, so we discovered, yeah, it's very hard to find a solution to connect these small devices to blockchain. Another topic are mobile applications. Do you know a mobile application which runs a synchronizing blockchain client? Actually not. Most of them, they are using also remote connections, because when you run a synchronizing blockchain client, yeah, the end user will not be happy, because it consumes a lot of energy, consumes a lot of bandwidth, and so on. And also web applications. A web application cannot run a blockchain client. It can use a blockchain client when it's on the computer, or it can use a remote service. But with InQue, can also run a blockchain client directly in a web page. So what is our goal? So when we think about existing solutions, then most of them are using centralized services, are not secure. The client, so the application itself, cannot validate what comes from the blockchain. We want to do this with a very secure system. Then, and also, yeah, when we think about the IoT devices, yeah, we have very, very small devices with capabilities which are not able to run any existing client. And when you think about Geth, Parity, Netamind, or other clients, you will never have the ability to run them on a microcontroller. And so our target was to go to small devices like smart meters, door locks, and other very small devices that we can really get blockchain into these devices without the need of a centralized service in between. This is the picture we actually wanted to have when Ethereum started. We have a decentralized network where peers are connected to each other, and we have dApps running on these computers communicating with these dApps. So this is how it should look like. But this is how it looks like in most cases. We have this nice network, completely decentralized, but to connect to the blockchain, we need centralized services. So at this point, this is not a bad thing. It was very essential in the past that we had these gateways. Otherwise, we would not have been able to start developing decentralized applications. But now when we go into the next steps, we really need decentralized ways to access blockchain, even for small devices, for dApps running on small devices. So when we talk about clients, you know, in Ethereum, so I can run a full node or archive node, even bigger. So we made this experiment at Slockit to run an archive node. It's really fun. And so now our archive node is almost on the end. So we need several thousand euros to extend the storage because it's too big. But even if you run a normal full node, it takes way more resources than you can run on a small device. And even if you use a light client, you need much or way more resources you have. For instance, the light client always is connected to the network. It needs to synchronize at least the block header information. So when you think about, for instance, a door lock, and this door lock needs to be connected to blockchain because you have the access management on blockchain. If this door lock is always synchronized with the blockchain, then your battery will be at the end of the power very soon. If it's not, then you come to the door. First, the client needs to synchronize. You maybe need to wait a moment, maybe a longer moment. That's not usable in real life. And that's why what are most IoT solutions are using? They are using remote clients. And with remote clients, yes, you have a single point of failure. And I think this is even more important, the client itself, the device itself, cannot check the data. It receives data, it has to trust that the data is correct, which it receives. With Incubed, we try to connect the abilities from the light client, that it can validate all the information by itself, with the good things of a remote client, that it doesn't need to synchronize. So, and with Incubed now, we can have a complete decentralized solution. We have several nodes in our decentralized network, which are normal full nodes in the network, which also run the Incubed protocol. And by this, are able to serve the Incubed network as nodes, so that the clients can connect to any of these Incubed nodes in the network. And in this way, we don't have the need for a single centralized instance. And the next point is that the Intune client will be in the point that it can validate everything by itself. Before I go a little bit into the details how the protocol works, some words to the Intune client. So we call it also a minimal verification client, a client with minimal resource consumption, which is able to verify and validate all the information by itself. So it is not part of the peer-to-peer network. It is stateless, means it doesn't need the synchronizing information. Yeah, it needs way less resources. Simon and Paul will talk a little bit more what really is needed. Yeah, and one also very important thing is, so with this client, because it doesn't need to synchronize information from one blockchain, it doesn't need to store any state information. And in this way, we can communicate with several blockchains at the same time. At the moment, we support also putting all Ethereum protocol-based blockchains, but you can talk to a private chain and at the same time talk to a public Ethereum with the same client without any changes. So how is it working? First, we have these nodes. These are full nodes running in the network, and these nodes can register in a registry smart contract. So they do this, give some metadata, and also they give a security deposit, a stake, so to call. And all the clients can synchronize this list of nodes. And with this, they have the information, which are the nodes I can talk to. And now, when one of these clients needs information, then it synchronizes or has this list, and it can look up which of these nodes is able to answer my questions. I also see how much deposit they have, what is the reputation of them, and so on. And now this client selects one of these nodes. In this case, it would be node B, and sends an RPC request to this node. And as response, it receives, of course, the result it asked for, but also it receives the Merkle proof for this block where the information is in, and also the block header. So and with this information, the client by itself can check that this information comes from this block, because it can calculate it with the Merkle that it belongs to this block. At this point, of course, the client is not or has no ability to check if this is the real block. Node B could send a from block. That's why the client also selects other nodes from the node list and asks these nodes for a validation. And validation means it asks them to sign the block hash of the block where the information comes from. So why we need this information? So when the client now has the information, this is the block where the information comes from, and this block others gave the witness that this is a true block, then we can rely on it. And what happens if they give us a wrong information? So first, all the nodes can check if the signed block hash is correct. And if the block hash is not correct, then they can go to the smart contract, to the legacy contract, and convict the node which gave the wrong information. Which means this node loses his deposit and is thrown out of the network. So that means for the client, he knows exactly, okay, I selected three nodes, they have this deposit, and if they give me a wrong information, they will lose this deposit. So I have a crypto economic incentive for the node to give honest answers. And that's why another term for our client is a crypto economic client. I can be sure that I get the information in a crypto economic way. And if I, for instance, have a question where the worth of this question is 10 euro, then I can look in the list and say, okay, I select nodes that the value of their stake is higher than the value of my transaction. Of course, when I want to open the door lock of my 2 million house, then when I only select nodes with a very small amount, this might be a problem. But then I can select other nodes or a bigger number of nodes to get the validation that I get really an amount which makes me secure enough for this request. So in this case, the node B, he can of course automatically check nodes A and C, but also we can put additional active watchdog into the network so that they can send requests to node A, node C, and node B and ask them for a signed block hash, but they act as a client but have a connection to the blockchain also. That means they know what is the real answer. And now if node A would give a wrong answer, they can convict them directly. So with these active watchdogs, I can bring a higher level of security if I think it's needed. And for instance, if I think maybe there are some compromised nodes in the network and want to be secure that my application is not compromised, then I can put some of these watchdogs in the network and can try to find if there are some compromising nodes. And the node cannot see if this is a client or if this is a watchdog. And that's why the risk to give a not correct answer is even higher. Okay, at this point, what can happen to the node? The node needs to stake to give a deposit. If he answers correctly, everything is well. If not, he loses his deposit. And this is quite not nice incentive for a node to exist. If you, the only thing is you lose something, but you cannot gain something, it's not too easy to incentivize people to run these nodes. That's why we are working on an incentive system, which means every request I send, I have to pay a very small amount of money, which is less than 0.0 something cent. But in the sum, all these nodes receive a reward for answering and signing block hashes and giving correct information. So the incentive model at the moment is something we are working on. This is not yet in the stable release. This stable release is everything I explain except the incentive model. So Christoph will go a little bit more in detail what we are doing at the moment on this. And so we expect within this year, the next month, we will release the next stable 2 version, which also has an incentive model inside so that it can start to be used in the full way. So as I said, our client is not dependent on one chain, so it can connect to nodes of blockchain A, maybe public Ethereum, but at the same time, it can also talk to other blockchains. So at the moment, as I said, we are supporting all Ethereum protocol-based blockchains, but also other blockchains are in development. We are working on an implementation for Bitcoin and also other data services like IPFS, which is actually already implemented, but also other data services can be included in the protocol. So what is the benefit of this? You can run on your device or on your mobile app or on your web page one client which can connect to all chains you need now or you may need in the future without the need to run or to synchronize all information from these chains. Okay, what additions we have? So Incubed is ultra-light client, which means it can do all or everything you can ask via RPC. It can do all calls, ask for accounts, interact with smart contracts. This is the full version, but we have also two smaller versions. The smallest one is the nano version, which only can check transaction receipts. So for a lot of applications, this is enough. This is the smallest edition, which is possible, needs something about 150k. And the basic can interact with the state, and the full, as I said, also interact with smart contracts. Last picture is the roadmap. So we are now here, beginning of 2020. We release the TypeScript version of the Incubed client as stable release, and also the C version as beta release. The full stable release of the C version will be within the next months. Yeah, and the next steps we are working on is the incentive system. We want to finish it within the next half year or so. And we also are working on wrapper applications so that you can use it not only in C or in TypeScript, but also in Java, in Go, in Python, in other languages. And we also have a Wasm client, which is also already existing, so we'll also talk a little bit about this. And then in the next months, we're also looking into the ETH 2.2 development, that we also can make our client ready for ETH 2 and also for other technologies to include them into the protocol. Okay, are there any questions?